Welcome to the University of Michigan Dentistry Podcast Series, promoting oral health care worldwide.
Let's briefly review our maxillary molars, again starting with the first molar. This is usually in about six, is primarily a grinding tooth. We've got the largest occlusal table on it of any tooth in the mouth. Frequently is referred to as the most important single chewing tooth in the mouth, the six-year molar, or the first permanent molar. We sometimes will call it permanent in contrast to the deciduous molars. Our first maxillary molar, we have our four cusps on this very characteristically, each termed by the surface in which they're located. We won't go over them specifically here now. We have sometimes a fifth cusp, which protrudes or develops off of the largest cusp on here, the mesial lingual cusp. Our two buccal cusps, about even in size, our lingual cusps, the mesial lingual being considerably larger than our distal lingual, which has a tendency to get smaller and fade out as we go to our second and thirds here. Not a lot of new terminology per se, in so much as we're just surface orienting our pits and fosses and grooves and what have you. But we do have this oblique ridge, which we indicated to you ran from the mesial lingual cusp to the distal buccal cusp, this being a very important ridge in this tooth. We do have our central pit surrounded by the fossa. We do have a buccal groove. This is, just has one term. It comes out straight to the buccal and crosses down onto the buccal surface, not crossing the height of contour. But this is all called buccal groove. Now, on the distal pit, we have a groove coming out to the lingual. And this groove has two terms, really. When it's in the occlusal portion of it, it's called distal lingual groove. And when it crosses our cusp ridge here and comes down the lingual surface, it's generally called just the lingual groove. So it could be referred to as either the distal lingual or the lingual groove, kind of depending upon which surface it's prominently located on. And this frequently does cross the height of contour of the lingual surface and oftentimes down onto the root. We got the rhomboid basic shape, but our other pits, grooves, fissures, mesial marginal ridge, distal marginal ridge, our triangular ridges, our cusp ridges, we have to identify them according to the cusps now, are all basically just termed according to the particular cusp and surfaces that they're located on. Our roots are three, and have the terms according to the root surfaces are located on. The largest root, usually the lingual root, and being somewhat round in character, although the first has a tendency to flatten as this groove comes down in here, and sometimes actually grooves right onto the root. But otherwise, basically round, our very broad, flat, mesial buccal root, and our smaller, the smallest of the three, distal buccal root, which is kind of pulled and tucked under the crown a little bit more than the rest of them and makes this distal buccal line angle very prominently rounded in the cervical portion here, as we had indicated. That should review your basic terminology. Let's look at some of the differential characteristics between our first, second, and third. And one thing we should identify here, and meant to do this before, and that is the term embrasure. Embrasure refers to the area located between the marginal ridges and the contact point. This is an area in which when you're chewing, the food comes into this area and then has to go out either to the buccal or the lingual. So we've got a kind of a triangular area bordered by the marginal ridges of our two adjacent teeth and the apex of our triangle being the contact point. This whole area through here is termed an embrasure area. That's a term that we should put into our vocabulary here now. If we look at the differential spotting characteristics of these teeth. We find that our first is generally a little wider from the mesial to the distal, and our second becomes a little smaller, as does our third in the mesial distal dimensions. Our first is rhomboid, a little bit sharper on the corners. Our second still is rhomboid, but starting to become rounded a bit. Our first has a very strong, prominent oblique ridge traversing obliquely across the tooth. Our second, this oblique ridge is not as strong and frequently is crossed by this central groove coming from the central pit into the distal pit. Our first has a much larger distal lingual cusp, and our second, this distal lingual cusp, gets proportionally smaller. Our first frequently has this distal lingual groove, and actually as it gets out onto the lingual groove, crossing the height of contour and coming down onto the root portion of the tooth. Whereas in the second, this generally lingual groove does not cross the height of contour of this tooth, generally stops, and we do not have a groove on the root. The root is usually nice and round in this area and doesn't flatten or actually groove. We have the differences of the root structures themselves, the first having a higher trifurcation or a trifurcation closer to the crown, therefore having a shorter root trunk, the roots being rather widely spread, and particularly this lingual root extending out beyond the width of the crown. In our seconds, our crowns are usually underneath, our roots are usually underneath the crown, and our roots are not as widely spread, sometimes actually becoming fused. Here's a mesial, broader flat mesial buccal root that's fused with the lingual root. On the distal here, they're still somewhat separate, but they do come down under the crown rather distinctly and haven't got this groove here. Our third molars are difficult to characterize because they're so variable. We generally say if we haven't got strong first or second characteristics, then we would be a third. Third's generally more heart-shaped, being very irregular in its crown anatomy, occlusal anatomy, having a very small, if at all, distal lingual cusp present at all. One of the things that's sometimes helpful in these is if we find that we have a contact point, such as we are showing along in here, on the distal of a tooth, then we know it's a second. Certainly couldn't be a third if we had a contact point on this surface. So occasionally somebody come up and say, this is a third molar, isn't it? And we'll look at it and find a real distinct contact point. We know that it has to be a second, even though the other characteristics sometimes will vary towards a third. It's a gradual gradation from tooth to tooth as these changes occur, and there's no one characteristic that you can say outweighs or is more important than the other characteristics. Characteristics, I think, are probably the most important are the oblique ridge, this lingual groove, the size and squareness of our crown, and our actual root being the last main characteristic as far as it's being under the crown or extended out beyond the crown and the height of the trifurcation in relation to our cervical line. Don't think you should have a great deal of difficulty distinguishing these if we kind of toss out and don't concentrate on distinguishing our third molars. We've tried to, in the teeth that we're furnishing to you, eliminate most of the third molars. These are the ones we always get sent to us in great numbers. In fact, is we've got just gallons and gallons of third molars in our tooth room, but we've tried to separate them out and give you just mainly first and seconds with a few occasional thirds so that you don't spend a lot of time studying these very highly irregular teeth whose roots often fuse on them. Let's outline these a little bit in sketch form here. One of the things I think we should be able to do is to sketch these teeth, and the occlusal anatomy becomes fairly distinct in these teeth. If we were to sketch a maxillary, say, first molar, first thing we'd want to do would be to identify the central pit. The central pit is almost exactly in the center of the tooth. We would also have a mesial pit and a distal pit. We'd have a groove connecting up these two, but not necessarily the central and the distal because of our oblique ridge. Let's identify some cusps here. We have a mesial buccal cusp and a distal buccal cusp, approximately evenly oriented in their segments, and these are separated by our buccal groove that comes straight out the buccal surface, not at an angle, but straight out the buccal surface, down onto the buccal, but not over the height of contour. So this separates them fairly evenly on the buccal surface. On our lingual surface, we've got two cusps. Our mesial lingual is not directly in line with our mesial buccal. Actually, it's a little bit to the distal and a little bit towards the center. So we may expect to find it along in here, but actually it's a little bit towards the middle of the tooth and a little bit more towards the distal. It's the largest one of all of them, not only in mass but in height. Our distal lingual being the smallest and located in the area here. We've got one other very prominent groove in this tooth, and this is our distal lingual groove, which comes out and actually comes at an angle, comes over and comes down our lingual surface to the point that it crosses the height of contour, so that if you look at this tooth, you'll find an actual dipping in the outline form of the tooth right here where this is crossing the height of contour. We would hope that you'd be able to identify that. Now we've got our oblique ridge. This is something that is frequently confusing to students because they like to draw the oblique ridge right straight between our mesial lingual and our distal buccal cusp, and it doesn't go right straight across. It actually comes off and goes rather significantly towards the distal of the tooth before it traverses over to the distal buccal cusp. And it kind of divides our tooth into a mesial two-thirds and a distal third. So it's not sectioning right through the center of the tooth, but it's going towards the distal and dividing it into a mesial two-thirds and a distal third. Now we may have grooves that will come up this a little bit, but they generally don't cross. Occasionally we will have a little groove coming out the mesial pit and up to our mesial marginal ridge, mesial groove, mesial marginal groove, but not real characteristic. Now if we were to take and to draw in our marginal ridges on this, we'd find we had a mesial marginal ridge, our mesial buccal cusp ridge, distal buccal cusp ridge, distal marginal ridge, distal lingual cusp ridge, mesial lingual cusp ridge, and this gives us our occlusal table. Basically, the area in between our cusp ridges, marginal ridges, will be the occlusal table of the tooth. We could also continue to identify some grooves, some ridges on it. The most prominent ridge beyond this is our mesial buccal triangular ridge that comes down into the central groove here. This is probably the most prominent of our triangular ridges actually coming into the central area of the tooth. Our triangular ridges here kind of are connecting up into our oblique ridge, and actually I guess that's fairly prominent, but we're not calling this a triangular ridge anymore. It's an oblique ridge. For our triangular ridges, our mesial buccal is certainly the strongest. But basically speaking, the things we would be looking for in an outline sketch of this is that we have the rhomboid shape of the tooth. Our sides here are somewhat parallel, but not at right angles to our buccal or lingual surface. We've got basically a rhomboid, a square tip to the side here a little bit. We've got our central fossa right in the center of the tooth, buccal groove coming straight out the buccal surface, but not crossing the height of contour. Lingual groove coming out obliquely, cross or be distal lingual and lingual, coming out obliquely, crossing the height of contour. We'd expect our buccal cusp to be the same size and approximate location in proportion to the mass of the tooth. We'd expect to find our lingual cusp to be the largest and not located directly opposite our mesial buccal, but a little bit towards the center and distal. So this gives you basic ideas on our occlusal anatomy. Now you may say, why so much, you know, talk about occlusal anatomy? Well, restoring these teeth, we get involved in restoring occlusal anatomy to a rather significant extent. And these are old amalgam restorations. They've tarnished with age and turned rather black, but quite frequently we're required to replace this anatomy with amalgam restorations in a matter of 5 minutes or less, which means that you have to carve back the entire occlusal anatomy in 5 minutes or less. So you've got to know exactly where that central pit goes, exactly where the grooves are going to be, and know it so well that just automatically you can go right to it and put it into shape rather rapidly. We're using wax in the laboratory now, and I don't think that any of you are going to produce a very quality wax carving in 5 minutes, but when we get to our amalgams and in the mouth of this size, they have to be done in 5 minutes. Now, obviously, these are extremely poor, and many of those that you find in the, you know, extracted teeth will be extremely poor, and that's probably one of the reasons why they're in the extracted teeth, is because the overall quality of dentistry has been so poor that these teeth just, you know, didn't make it. And this is not always the patient's fault. It's sometimes the fault of the dentist not being capable of producing the anatomy, and if they don't know it, certainly they can't produce it. We looked at this piece of jawbone that had the posterior teeth in it here a while back, but you might just look at this in relation to the overall outline form of these teeth. As far as the rhomboid nature, particularly of this first molar, it has worn rather significantly on the occlusal, but it's got rather sharp rhomboid outline. Notice how this second is starting to round, and it's getting a little smaller in its mesial distal dimension. Buccal lingually about the same, getting a little smaller mesially distally, but it still has the basic rhomboid nature. Our third, smaller yet, and because of our smaller distal lingual cusp, it's having a tendency to become on the heart-shaped form. But within the same jaw, you can get an idea of the different teeth. Now, very frequently, we're called upon in the mouth to identify these molars by looking at their occlusal anatomy, because this is basically all you see on them, is their occlusal anatomy. And if one of them is missing, or if only one is present, you have to kind of figure out which one is which. Basically, our crown length is totally shorter than our bicuspid length, and it gets continuously shorter as we go to the posterior. Our third molar crown length is almost 2 millimeters shorter than our bicuspid length. We have broader dimensions in some areas, but shorter dimensions in the total crown length. They're coming, we call them short and fat. They're getting broader in their mesial distal buccal lingual dimensions and shorter occlusal cervically. Well, are we ready to take a quiz here this morning? We've made this review rather brief. We spent quite a little time on our original lecture here this morning.
You've been listening to a presentation from the University of Michigan School of Dentistry, which is dedicated to supporting open learning and open educational resources. This recording is licensed under the Creative Commons. It may be reused and redistributed for nonprofit use. Please attribute materials to the University of Michigan School of Dentistry and redistribute under this same license. For more information on how this and other University of Michigan School of Dentistry recordings may be used, visit www.dent.umich.edu/license.